Hey guys, what's up? If you're new to the channel, I'm Brian Makse, car critic, and what I'm known for, or what we're known for on this channel, is a straight up review and story about cool cars. And in this episode, we're going to have a look at this, the McLaren 570S, as well as its racing counterpart, the GT4. And these things are a blast. The road cars are amazing, but I think the race car is going to be something special. So let's go have a look and see what these McLaren 570s are all about. For some context, we need to look at what this 570S is all about, just to understand the GT4. So let's get into the 570S, and what we're actually going to find though is, while we know the 570S is a formidable car, the GT4 is very, very different.
For starters, the 570S is part of McLaren's Sport Series range. It begins, as all McLarens do, with a rigid lightweight carbon fiber tub, which is key to the 570's magic. Here's the thing, while anyone can do a carbon fiber tub, not many supercar builders do, and certainly none in the volume that McLaren does, which makes this company's range of cars very unique. The 570S weighs in at under 3,000 pounds, making it very light on its feet, and with that rigid chassis, it allows McLaren's engineers to calibrate the suspension with a remarkable combination of comfort and handling. Unlike the 720S, the suspension is a straightforward setup featuring double wishbones, conventional anti-roll bars, springs, and adaptive dampers. The engine is a variation of McLaren's twin-turbo smallish displacement V8, here 3.8 liters. Sure, we can be a bit desensitized given today's power wars, but 562 horses at 7,400 RPM is nothing to sniff at. On the other hand, unlike most modern turbocharged engines, the 570S makes a relatively modest amount of torque, just 443 pounds, with peak torque at a very high 5,000 to 6,500 RPM. Still, even with the turbochargers, throttle response is crisp and linear, and if you didn't know any better, you'd think this was a naturally aspirated engine. It's that good. Even with those qualities, it's brutally quick, 0 to 100 kilometers an hour in 3.2 seconds, the quarter in under 11, and it tops out at 328 kilometers or 204 miles an hour for my American friends. The 570's acceleration and overall driving pleasure is helped by the exceptionally quick 7-speed dual clutch gearbox. McLaren calls this their seamless shift gearbox, and yes, it's pretty darn seamless. Shifts are effectively imperceptible, which is the key reason modern supercars have gone in this direction. Seating position is near perfect, with excellent forward visibility, and the cabin feels airy and open despite the narrow pitch between the seats. Interior design is McLaren minimalist, entirely the opposite of the Italians, who seem to prefer visual drama for their cabins. The infotainment unit is unique to McLaren and is reasonably intuitive. The small panel between the seats contains the gear selector buttons, powertrain and handling knobs, and the start-stop button. What makes the 570S unique is its design ethos, indisputable supercar performance in a British supercar package, but with a ride that's comfortable enough for a long road trip. This supercar recipe is something that McLaren is able to deliver across its range without compromise. Very unique. From behind the wheel, the quality of the steering feel is what strikes you first. Response is immediate, the nuances of the road surface coming from the front contact patches are apparent, and you feel on top of the 570S rather than reacting to it. The steering rack is thankfully on the quick side, just the way I like it, and power assist is hydraulic. It's a rarity today given packaging and mass considerations, but there's no electric steering setup that can provide high fidelity feedback like a hydraulic system does. Dynamically, the 570S has plenty of natural mechanical grip, putting down power on corner exit with zero drama, and as speeds increase, there's a little positive aero effect to assist. Relying on the company's history in Formula 1, the 570's traction and stability systems work imperceptibly. Unlike nearly every other competitor, both near and far, the 570S uses an open diff and relies on software that subtly applies the brakes to manage cornering attitude. Like the gearbox, interventions are seamless, and unless you're on the track, you'd be hard-pressed to feel the system's working. Overall, my complaints about the road car are minor. The overly boosted brake actuation at low speeds can be annoying if you do a lot of city driving. Plus, there's the front axle lift system that should be activated by a button instead of digging down into a menu. Other than that, and the fact that there's not a 570S in my garage, there's nothing more to say. I love this McLaren.
enough about this road car. Let's get into the GT4 race car. And thanks to our pals at Compass Racing and factory McLaren driver Paul Holton, we get to have a spin in the amazing McLaren 570 GT4 at Watkins Glen. And I'll tell you a little secret later.
Like the BMW M4 GT4 I tested earlier this year, the 570S GT4 was developed to conform with global GT4 regulations. In this part of the world, the 570S GT4 competes against the M4, of course, Porsche Cayman GT4, AMG GT4, and Mustang GT4, among others. If you think about those competitors for a second, it's no surprise then that the McLaren has the smallest frontal area of all, often giving it the highest top speed in competition, which means that championships adjust the 570's balance of performance in other ways, and I'll get into that in a second. The 570S GT4 is very closely based on the road car, uses the same carbon tub, the same engine, transmission, and save for the roll cage and necessary racing bits, the interior is nearly a direct carryover from the road car. Even the turn signal stalk is there, which I used to direct the Porsche 962, yes, a 962, to pass me on track. The steering wheel is nearly identical to the street version, omitting the airbag, of course. The shift pedals are the same as the road car, as are the brake and throttle pedals. The aero package is slightly different, with a tall fixed rear wing, a large fixed splitter at the front, and a hood or bonnet, if you will, reshaped as an exit duct for the big racing radiator located in the nose of the car. Front and rear tracks are slightly wider than the road car, and the race car uses center lock wheels, of course. The GT4 drops the road car's adaptive dampers for a more conventional two-way racing damper setup, and there's also the necessary air jacking system. Steel brakes replace the road car's carbon ceramics. Overall, it really doesn't stray too far from the original road car, and that's a good thing. Before I get behind the wheel of the GT4, I have a chat with McLaren factory driver and old pal Paul Holton, who's the driver of this number 76 Compass Racing 570.
For the first time ever, we had an audio file that was corrupt, so we're going to reconstruct what Paul's saying, and what he's actually saying is,
I'm too sexy for my shirt, too sexy for my shirt, so sexy it hurts.
Just kidding. Paul told me everything that follows, and I'm going to directly quote him here.
Being a McLaren factory driver is pretty awesome, and I'm tasked with GT3 and GT4 development going forward, racing with customer teams, and showing what the cars can do. Being associated with McLaren is pretty special and very confidence-inspiring. It's very cool. About driving this car, you're taught at racing school to look through the car ahead of you, but it's hard because the McLaren sits so low compared to the other cars, and you're looking at their taillights. Our car is quite poised, but it doesn't have the outright grip because of the amount of weight we carry. But the way it handles and the way it transitions is very nimble, very cat-like and agile, even despite all the BOP adjustments. My advice to you is that you have to work with the electronics, the stability control, the traction control, because they can make your life real easy or real hard, depending on how you treat them. In the McLaren, you tend to square up the corner. It's kind of a point-and-shoot car. Think about having two sectors to the corner, a decel phase and an accel phase, and that's the quickest way to get this car around a racetrack. And hey, Brian, try to stay off the green stuff here at Watkins. Other than that, enjoy the car and don't have too much fun. And please don't crash it.
As soon as I slide behind the wheel, the sight lines from this racing supercar are unlike anything I've driven. While I've never driven one, it's romantic to think that this might be the view I'd get from a prototype rather than a production-based race car. Shortly after rolling out on track, it strikes me that this McLaren is tiny compared to other GT4s. The Mustangs and BMWs are so tall in comparison that they seem like school buses. From the driver's seat of the 570, you're at bumper height of these competitors, which is probably good and bad from a wheel-to-wheel racing standpoint. The biggest difference between the 570S and the 570S GT4 is that the race car is making 100 horsepower less than the road car. You heard that right, this McLaren has to be massively detuned in order to compete against these other GT4s. Plus, championships are adding weight to the 570S GT4 for its BOP. Now, let's not forget that there's road car fast and there's race car fast, and this McLaren race car is much, much faster than the road car on track. I'm enjoying that same excellent steering with the quick rack and excellent feedback. Even more so than in the road car, the GT4 steering has a wickedly positive feel, which is a massive advantage over the BMW M4 GT4 that I drove. This is an open test day, and the speed differential between this Compass Racing McLaren and any of the road cars is staggering, race car fast indeed. Still, compared to the top IMSA Continental GS lap times, I'm well off the pace since this isn't my car, and I'm being careful, and well, Paul insisted he wants to race this car in the near future. Also, I'm right foot braking simply because I'm more confident with my right, but the trick is certainly to left foot brake this thing, so that's not doing me any lap time favors either. No, I'm not sharing my lap times here, thank you very much. Plus, I've got a little Watkins Glen secret to share in a minute. Overall, this is the most compelling race car I've driven in a long time. What's interesting is that for a production-based car, it's the closest thing you can get to a prototype racer. But among the GT4 race cars, it may very well be the closest in specification to its road car counterpart, and that in itself is remarkable. Perhaps that is the spirit of the GT4 category, to truly race what you sell. Most importantly though, I think it must be brilliant to race this McLaren wheel-to-wheel against some truly stout competition. Yes, Paul, if I'm being honest, I'm definitely envious.
And that was a blast. One of the things I didn't bother to tell our friends at Compass Racing is that I've never actually driven Watkins Glen before until I drove it in their McLaren, but that's okay. Did a lot of sim time on Watkins Glen, and you know, the car is so easy to drive, and the circuit's a heck of a lot of fun, and it was a blast trying the GT4 there. Thanks for hanging out with us today and having a look at these two amazing McLarens. Hope you liked this piece. If you did, be sure to click like, share, and subscribe. And as always, we want to know what you think, so please leave a comment below. Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you again next time.